Hi, I'm Mike Todd with ASCAP, and I'm thrilled to introduce composers Rohan Hilton and Jacob Yaffe, the duo behind the score and theme to ABC's reimagining of The Wonder Years for this episode of ASCAP Screen Time. Their collaboration started in 2016 for the LeBron James series Best Shot, along with a number of projects that followed. And joining Jacob and Rohan, I'm also excited to introduce Bert Blacharach, the music supervisor for The Wonder Years, who in addition is an acclaimed composer, music producer, DJ, and Grammy-winning sound engineer who touts a 20-plus year writing partnership with rock and roll Hall of Fame inductee Public Enemy and frontman Chuck D. Great to meet you, Bert. Thanks for joining us well. and steering the conversation about your work together on this hit series. I'm really curious to hear how you all landed on this gig and which one of you got the gig first. So with all that in mind, Bert, please take it away. Thanks.
Is that the first question to answer right there? Are you throwing me the first question, Michael? I heard a rumor that I was the first person interviewed and the first person hired. So I guess I was the first one.
Mm-hmm.
And Jacob and Rohan, how the hell are you guys doing today?
All is amazing.
Man. That was a crazy 22 episodes, huh?
Wild.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, it was. Wild ride.
Those first like month and a half, we were like putting out two shows a week, just you guys re-recording every song under the sun with musicians doing COVID and Atlanta and New York. But however you guys pulled that off just still blows me away. I talk about it all the time. I haven't really seen anything like that or been a part of anything like that mayhem and the recording in Atlanta and New York and your musicians all over the place having to get COVID tests. So for that, I want to start off with was absolutely amazing. The time management, the communication, phenomenal. You definitely deserve a clap for that.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
You are welcome. So my first question is, how did you guys get involved with the show?
Hoo-wee. That's a good one. Good one, Bert. So it was 2020. I mean, we've said this a few times, but it was crazy because we honestly did not know what was happening in the world, period. We didn't know what was going to happen with our careers, what was happening with the music business. And to be honest with you, you know, we're going a little stir crazy being locked down. We formed a pod, obviously, because at the time we were working on another documentary and we didn't hear anything back from that either. So we're like, you know, we looked at each other like, what are we going to do? And we decided, you know, let's stay creative, like let's make an album and hopefully this can get licensed. And it just so happened that the sound of that album that we chose to do was in the 60s. And so ended up being really fortuitous for us. So we sent it off to our agents and our agent was like, hey, Fox has got a cool project, you know, it's called The Wonder Years. Are you guys interested? And we're like, yeah.
Wait, hold on for a second. So all that music I heard in the beginning, you didn't write for The Wonder Years. You guys did that karmically. You already had that in the can?
No, so we created an album first, right? That got us the meetings, right, with Jeremy and Ward. And then Jeremy and Ward introduced us to Sal. And then we went back in, right, we'd had a discussion about the actual show and the characters. And then we created a whole nother album for that. And then we got, you know, the details that we needed. We got picture. Merged it to picture, called our musician friends in, scored to picture. And then that's how we started on the pilot.
Mm-hmm. Wow. I just got tired. I just got a brain freeze trying to put that all together. That's incredible. How about you, Jacob? What was your perspective during this?
Well,
in the beginning, at least.
Yeah. In the beginning. Like Rohan said, it was 2020 and, we were unlucky in that all of the contracts and stuff we were on all wrapped in January that year. And we had a bunch of things, irons in the fire, as they say. And one by one, they just kept falling over, things getting postponed or canceled altogether. So we were just talking yesterday, you know, we were reminiscing and we had bet on ourselves and said, let's just make some music we are excited about. I've got a, you know, background in jazz and classical. Used to live in New York, and loved that time period so much. And I used to do gigs and bands that would play that kind of stuff. So we decided, hey, let's just do an album in that world, because we both love that era. And so often when you're a film composer, you don't have much choice. You have to write, the picture tells you what it needs. So it was kind of freeing just to make some music we like to listen to. And then it was like the universe just revealed this meeting with Jeremy and Ward, and they had heard that stuff, and they said, you know, you guys might be good for this Wonder Years thing. And of course, we didn't argue with him. And he said, you know, can you guys put together like a specific demo, you know, meet Sal and Fred and do the whole bit. And so we went in hard, because it was like a life raft. You know, we're like,
yeah,
this was August of 2020, something like that. I mean, we called in, of course, the musicians, it was a life raft for them too, because they hadn't been gigging. And luckily in New York, all our buddies there, they were in a pod. So they were able to go in a studio and record together in the room to get that band vibe. And I mean, everybody was just pouring as much into it as possible. We called in our good friend Scotty Grand. He sang on a couple of the those initial tracks. And
oh, I mean, there's that one song that we used in the pilot when Martin Luther King was MLK passed away. Died. Oh my God, you remember that? Oh, that piece is beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, and that all came about during that time. You know, it's like the passion, and I think you can just feel it. Everybody was just so into it. Everybody just bring, you know, it's great when people bring stuff that you can't pay for. Like, no check is going to bring passion. Correct. And that's what I think came out from that era, just the hunger and the excitement from not only Rowan and I, but also every musician, every vocalist, the string player, everything. Just was awesome. And so we sent it off, and in typical Hollywood fashion, it was crickets. We didn't
it was
hear
crickets
nothing.
For me for like it was crickets for me for like 6 months, man. It was the wildest thing ever.
Yeah. And then we get the call, we get on a Zoom with Sal and Fred. They're like, okay, you guys ready to go? We're like, oh, is this happening?
But one thing to add on, because we didn't hear back from anything, you know, Jacob went to Hawaii. I was in Jamaica. Because we're, you know, I don't know if you guys were like us in 2020, after a while being stir crazy in the house, we're like, we need to go somewhere and be humans. Sure, we want to create music, but like, let's be humans. So Jacob's on an island, I'm on an island. And then we have that amazing Zoom with you, Amani, where we all meet for the first time. And it was like, oh, we got the gig.
Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah, absolutely amazing. I think here's my next question I got for you. This is probably the hardest thing any musician, songwriter, singer, composer can ever have to deal with: the original theme song from The Wonder Years. The original song is arguably one of the greatest songs ever written in the history of music.
Agreed.
The cover.
Sure.
Is arguably the greatest cover ever sang by any song. So, right? I mean, you know, I'm not exaggerating, because we can have these arguments with other people, and it's like you can't shoot it down. I mean, that cover is unbelievable. Mm-hmm. So knowing that information, and finding out that you two had an opportunity to do a theme song, knowing that you had to kind of capture that same feeling, how did you guys approach it?
Honestly, Imani, like, we tried not to think about it. We were like, to be honest with you, like, we didn't want to think about John Lennon, you know, while we're in the in the booth. You know, there's a thing called camps that a lot of people in the recorded music business know about, where you get a whole bunch of people together, preferably who know each other, and create a whole bunch of music. But first for us, you know, because we come out of a pod, we'd made so much music for the pilot, we immediately called our amazing friend and collaborator, Scotty Grand. And there was a score piece that Jacob had played for me, and he was like, yo, this is the start of something. What do you think? What do we need to add to it? And I was like, man, this could be the main titles. We kind of argued about it a little bit, and I was like, speed it up a little bit. And he was like, you sure? I'm like, yeah. And so brought Scotty in, and the three of us sat right where Jacob is right now. And we just started sussing out ideas. And, you know, then also after that, I called in some legendary friends, called in Lucky Day. He just won the Grammy for R&B Album of the Year, called in Ilse Juber. She's written for Beyonce, and Jay Angel, who's written for Rihanna. I got some other amazing and magical songs, sent them all in. And at the end of the day, Saladin was like, it's the first one. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to be honest with you, had a great conversation with the brilliant, brilliant composer last night. And one of the things he was saying is, you know, great score and great songs are already there. You just got to chisel away the resistance, you know. And I think one of the big parts of resistance for us, Bert, would have been thinking about, like I said, John Lennon in the booth with us. So, you know, we wanted to get as many good emotions, good feelings about the show, what the original meant to us, what this reimagining would mean to us, get in that state and create something we all love. And the great thing is, you know, we had a legend like Scotty Grand who could deliver on our ideas. Because I guarantee you, if it was me or Jacob singing in that booth, I would have mercy.
I've yet to hear that demo.
Never will. Yeah.
And Bert, I got to put on record here. You are the reason that we got the shot. Yep. It was you recommending to Sal, you know, hey, let's give Rowan and Jacob a chance to throw their hat in the ring. So, dude, yeah, forever grateful for the opportunity. And we went in full tilt, did not want to disappoint. But yeah, dude, much love and respect for you throwing it our way.
Absolutely, my pleasure. It was so cool. I mean, you know what, the one of the best things about the theme song is how it starts off with that little guitar lick.
Yeah. Yes,
man, that brings it all together.
It is that guitar lick.
That was my little edit idea, everybody, where it wasn't quite starting how everybody liked. I said, oh, let's start with the guitar lick, and the composers were like, yeah, that's great. And I was shocked that they thought it was a good idea.
Yeah, it kicked it off. It's a hard thing when you take a full song and say, okay, now cut it down to 10 seconds.
Exactly.
It's like, oh, you're scratching your head like, oh, how are we going to pull this off? So
this next question I got for you, I'm not sure what's better, the name or the resume, but the original composer for Wonder Years, you may or may not know everybody, his name was Snuffy Walden. So how did Snuffy's sound inspire you guys to attack the show?
Well, I'll say that, you know, that those are some mighty big shoes to fill. I mean, Snuffy is an incredible guitarist and composer, and obviously the original is iconic. The main thing that we wanted to do was have it stand on its own, and obviously it's about a different family. So we felt like we were allowed to kind of take a different direction. Mm-hmm. I know at first we kind of were told like, hey, maybe you guys kind of follow after what Snuffy had done. But we were eager to take the approach that since the father figure in this iteration is a musician, he's got his own band, he plays funk, jazz, soul, R&B, all that stuff. We thought, wouldn't it be cool if the entire score was performed by what could be his band? And so we took that and said, okay, we're going to score the scene, but let's only use the instruments that would be in Bill's band the entire time, and then augment as necessary. There were a few moments where we stepped away from it, like the MLK Dies sequence. We decided, oh man, it would be great to use a cappella vocals to start, just to kind of really, really support that. But the quick pitch that we kind of decided, and we said with ourselves, we said, if the first iteration is Bob Dylan, this iteration is Bill Withers. Mm-hmm. And that was like the basic thing we always ask ourselves when we start writing. We said, okay, which way are we leaning? We want to always go towards Bill Withers.
Yeah, and I would say, you know, we all came into the show with an idea of what this version of the show would be, obviously, because of the storied history, right? Like,
absolutely.
For Jacob and I, this is, you know, childhood reimagined, you know, and so mm-hmm. we thought it would sound a certain way. But when we got into to picture, we saw the characters, the relationship with the characters, then we saw the story that Sal was crafting, it just kind of, you know, had a mind of its own, had a life of its own. And it really helped, you know, having the character Bill Williams being a jazz musician, and having funk and soul roots, and getting to listen to that kind of music every day, right? That just kind of propelled the score into the shape that you now hear. And also as the series, you know, evolved itself, as the show got into its episodes, there's more drama, more dynamics that we could call back, more themes that we could call back, more relational elements that we could bring together, and some other cool alley-oops that we got from Saladin to be able to reimagine some other stuff in there. So a lot of fun doing this.
Yeah, this is a dream come true musically. It's unbelievable to be able to be involved with a show that's got so much music, so much freedom. Yes. The bed that Saladin has just laid out for us is it's unbelievable. It's really, really cool. You know, and that leads me to, like, this show is really rare that it kind of explores the experience of the middle class Black family in the 60s. Mm-hmm. How did that influence both of yours show on work on the show?
Well, I would say, first and foremost, you know, seeing a middle-class Black family in the civil rights era, as you said, Imani, is a rare thing, period. We were talking about that early on as we were interviewing. Ceci, our amazing costume designer, brought great points to us. She was basically saying, hey, look, I'm looking for set design and costume design, just of, you know, normal Black life in this time. And she's like, I had to go to my own photos from my own family. And it was really touching for us because we really thought about it, like, yeah, wait a minute. You know, when is the last time we've seen this on network television? And so for us musically, we're like, okay, this is new. Let's make it sound new, right? Like, let's reimagine that sound and that era and that style and something that's authentic to that sound and that time, but that feels of the moment, right? And that tells this coming of age story effectively. And that's why we were able to reference Otis Redding and Aretha Franklin. And of course, as Jacob just mentioned, Bill Withers, one of my favorites. And trivia for you guys, you nerds, both Burt's father and Saladin's father are musicians of that time. And, you know, Burr was so kind as to lend us some real authentic original songs that some of them we've got to reimagine and repurpose and reproduce for the show. But it has this authentic feel of the time and of the moment, and of those legendary Black voices, right? And just saying that gives me chills to be able to do that on network television in a way that's both authentic and of this time. So that very much influenced us, man. And I'm super excited to see, as the show progresses, how more of this story is involved, specifically with the Vietnam War stuff going on with Bruce, our eldest brother of the show, obviously.
Hey, Kim. Wait. We don't want to spill the beans too much.
Yeah, man. Well, no, you know, that's already happened in season one. But, you know, one of our leads, Kim, played by Laura, who does an amazing job. She's heavily involved in the civil rights movement. So it's really cool to be able to model music after Marvin Gaye and call it score. Yep. It's amazing.
On a side note, if you Google Eula Cooper, E-U-L-A Cooper, she did about four or five of Bill Williams, who is Saladin's father, Bill Patterson's songs. So Google Eula Cooper and look for the credits Bill Patterson, and that's Saladin's father who wrote those songs. And I've got a question for you, Jacob. You guys created a ton of music for the show. Can you talk about some of the musicians and singers you brought along the way? Because you mentioned having a jazz background, having a lot of jazz musicians you worked with in New York, and you mentioned that you brought them in to work on some of this stuff. So can you touch on that?
Sure. Yeah, we were kind of forced during the pandemic to, you know, change how we were recording. Everybody went remote, and it just worked out that a lot of, when I used to live in New York, I was gigging and playing with a lot of incredible jazz players who now have kind of branched out and do other types of music. Like I said before, a lot of them kind of formed a pod so they can continue to meet up and play. So we started tracking them using audio movers, and it worked out really well, which is how we continued the process throughout the season. It really sped things up. So there was a bevy of musicians that we've recorded in New York. I would say, musician-wise, the standout was Corey Henry, who joined us for episode 6 Came in and played the B3 organ for us for a church episode. And it's funny because we recorded the organ ahead of time. Like, hey, Corey, it needs to be something like this. And we played it for him, and he said, okay, play it back once. He's like, all right, okay, turn it off. And he laid down how it was really supposed to be, which was just like mind-blowing to
Right.
have done it first and then hear how, okay, that's how it's supposed to be. And those of you who don't know, Corey Henry is arguably the greatest living organist in Snarky Puppy, and I think he's gone solo now. And it was just wild to get to record a musician like that for a network comedy. It's just incredible. And then throughout the season, like Bert, you mentioned, there's a lot of musical moments that were on camera. So we were able to call, singers and people to play for us who had never recorded for film and television. We had some gospel vocalists, people living in Pennsylvania, people living in Georgia, living in New York, in Maryland, who recorded remotely for us, and this was their first opportunity. And I remember we were recording Michael, Rowan. Remember Michael? We did like a ridiculously long session. He was just like, his face was like covered in sweat. He was working so hard, like by the end, just to get everything down note perfect for us. So, I mean, like I said, the passion that was coming from everybody involved was like visceral. I mean, you could just feel it and you hear it. It's on screen. So yeah, like we always, every time we talk about Saladin, we just say like much love because he really threw some alley-oops for us.
Oh yeah, he's just beautiful. Saladin Patterson is really, really cool working with him. It's been the most amazing journey that I've dealt with, at least with my sync career, so to speak. You know, and that, you know, an episode, I think it was episode 120, the World of the Show episode, correct me if I'm wrong. Saladin fictionalized the theme song within, you know, within the whole show with on-screen performances. How do you even make that happen? How do you, like, because that was just from my end, it was really hard. How did you guys pull that off?
Well, it's called Bill's New Gig.
Okay,
And
thank you. Thank
yeah,
you. Thank
episode
you.
120. And again, Saladin really, really, really showed us some love here. But basically, in the episode, our characters, Bill and Lillian, played by Dulé Hill and Saikhon Singbo, respectively, they basically write our main titles as part of the show of the world, right? Or the world of the show, excuse me. And in typical musician fashion, they have conflict about lyrics and melody. And what's cool is Saladin builds in this cool interaction between the two for an overall conflict, right? And what's amazing is being able to not only showcase our theme song, but be able to record Dulé and Saikhon actually coming to the studio. Saikhon was in Atlanta, so we did a Zoom session, but Dulé came by. We got to record him directly, meet him for the first time in person. And those guys are amazing. It's their vocals. They killed it. Both extremely talented professionals in their own right. And the other cool thing is we got to make multiple versions of the main titles, right? The theme song. So we had this one super sultry R&B vocal version that has these crazy backgrounds that I came to love. And then we did a little faster paced versions of both Bill and Lillian singing the song so that they have a duet at the end. And then we got to do a rendition of Summertime. And then, another note of trivia. In that episode is Dulé Hill's actual real wife, Jasmine Simon, who came in and also laid some stuff down. So it was just a magical experience to get those live performances recorded, get the energy of the actors and the talent, and then reimagine the main titles in a way that fit the world of our show. It was a dream come true, to be honest with you.
Hey Jacob, what was your favorite musical moment of the season?
Man, there's so many to choose from.
Well, choose one, and you
Choose
got like
one. I'm
5 seconds.
going to
Hurry
say that
up.
the callback to the original series, the end of this one episode where
Oh, geez, Louise.
yeah, that
Yeah,
was
yeah.
such a, I mean, just such an incredible like twist for, from the writers to connect the two families like that. And it's so short. Those moments where you got to really hit people in the heart, like, and you're like, okay, you've got 25 seconds, make me cry.
Right.
And it just was such a powerful, it was just like, man, such a juicy cue for us to come up with.
I probably got the most phone calls off of that scene right there. Ever just blew everybody away. Really deep.
It was so unexpected. Yeah. It's great.
And then my favorite musical moment, I have a couple, but one that was great is a song that I love. I used to DJ with. It's called Struggling for Survival. And it's a scene where Kim is trying to find her voice in the Black Panther movement. So she's actually going to a meeting and she's bringing her little brother Dean with her. And then as they walk in, you hear the song Struggling for Survival. And I still get goosebumps over that. So that was my favorite musical moment.
Great moment.
Talking to both of you has been amazing. I learned a few things and we spent, feels like our whole lives together, going back and forth. And meeting and meeting like 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, right. First time.
Right.
Yeah. First time.
So I can't thank both of you enough for allowing me to interview you and kind of witnessing how you guys approach this show, because this has got to be one of the most difficult shows to deliver with. And you guys are turning things around in 2, 3, 4 days, even with COVID.
Exactly.
Man, I'm on you, sir. Well, yeah. Bert, thank you for everything, man, especially hooking us up in ways that we couldn't even see. We appreciate you, man.
All day. I got you. I got you. ASCAP, baby. Go ASCAP.
Not sure
ASCAP
how we
for
end.
President.
Yeah, ASCAP for president.